name's Robert Guy. I'm the director of the Appalachian program here at Southeast Kentucky Community Technical College. One time I studied on murder. So I got this book, it's called Homicide. And so they talk in there about Baltimore. And all the people get killed in Baltimore. 200, 300 people a year get killed in Baltimore. And the police talk about how it was always nerve-wracking and satisfying at the same time when somebody from Kentucky or West Virginia, some of these mountain people living up in Baltimore, kill one another. Now here's the thing, right? Usually, you can't get nobody to talk in the community about why somebody got killed or who done it. But they said when they were in the Appalachian community, it was always easy to get somebody to tell you what happened. Who done it? But the problem started because they didn't want to tell you why they done it. Which is really not very interesting to the police, right? And then they want to tell you what their mama and their grandmama and their great uncle had to do with it. They wanted to roll it all out. So that was one of the problems. The other problem was that when a mountain person was involved in a murder and they told you who done it, you had to go catch them real quick. Because they'd call them and they'd tell them, boy, you're in trouble. I done told them. And then they'd run back to the mountains. And this, of course, is the nature of storytelling. Once one starts, it's difficult to stop. But we have to discipline ourselves. We have to make choices. And so tonight is a series of choices made by a series of people over the last 10 years. We'd like to thank them by name. The cast you see tonight is a fraction of the total number of people who participated in this project. We've had over 200 people participate as actors in the Higher Ground series of plays. We've had three. First one was written by the late, great Joe Carson. We helped him. It was written by Barry Stroud. The second one was also directed by Jerry, and us and Joe put it together too. It was called Playing with Fire. Those first two plays, they dealt with drug abuse in our community. How to pull together as a family, as a community, to combat that problem. You'll hear some stories from those two plays. Also some about the coal mining stories from the church. Third play, it was called Talking Dirt. And we done that with the Carpetbag Theater from Knoxville, Tennessee.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Higher Ground. from up in Lynch. But we're from Cumberland.
I'm from Lynch. Cranks, about a mile from the Survival Center.
Grummings, where the commissary used to be.
And I'm a clover licker.
And I come from Lou Ellen. Now I'm from Mary Helen.
Mary Alice.
Lena Rue.
Twyla. Now those are places, not our mama's names. I'm straight out of Page Park.
I come from Maloney and light bread and a bag of Grippo.
I'm from pie crust made with water.
And I'm from soup, beans, and cornbread. Yeah.
And I'm from cooked salad and boiled eggs.
And I'm from neck bones and gullet.
Well, I'm from thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
I'm from 58 degrees, winter and summer, underground. We played together, we ate together, we sang together. But when we got to the top, a lot of times we went our own way.
Unless somebody's in trouble!
You may not realize this, but we live in a rainforest. And if you live in a rainforest, you are going to have some rain. Now, sooner or later, all that tries to go back to the seed that it came from. Runoff. Runoff that comes into confluence. Now today is also a confluence, a coming together of stories. You know, there's all kinds of rivers flowing. There's rivers of water, rivers of money, rivers of laughter, and rivers of tears. And today, there will also be rivers of stories.
Older folks always knew when the weather was really turning to rain.
This one's getting down in my bones. We best watch that river.
This is in my bones. Who? Watch that river. Watch how fast it rises.
Better move your cars to higher ground. Maybe your children to higher ground.
Over there belonged to my uncle. That chestnut post sticking out of the ground? That's what's left of the fence that used to run all the way down the boundary line, separating our two properties. Let's go this way a minute. See that big oak tree up there?
Yes.
That's the corner marker of my aunt's property. You didn't know her, she died before you was born. She was a feisty old gal. Wasn't scared of nothing. I'd seen her kill an eight-foot rattlesnake one day with a garden hoe and didn't even flinch. Walk over here just a little bit. Now, the top of our property is marked by a big cherry tree. I ain't been out here since your daddy died, son. That tree's up there somewhere.
Papa, what's all these trees called up down here?
I'll tell you exactly what that is. That's where they've been stripping coal on top of the mountain up there. It's coming down on us, and they pushed all that timber right over the hill. That cherry tree is down in there somewhere. Had mine and Gertie's initials carved in it. Now it's gone. Just like I will be soon.
Don't say that, Papa.
Now listen, son. Grandma and I have talked things over, but when I pass on, this land's going to you. I just hope you love and cherish it as much as we have. Let's go over here and sit down here at breath a minute. I love coming up here. I can sit here for hours looking at these mountains. It's beautiful. You hear that?
Hear what, sir?
You don't hear nothing, do you?
No.
That's what your own land gives you, son. Peace and quiet.
We said enough.
gonna sell us Papaw's land, don't you?
What?
Start some business over in Pineville, I reckon.
Julia, he wouldn't.
That's what Roger told me.
They will tear that place apart. Why won't he fight?
Fight for that place or fight for you? And why does everything have to be a fight?
What are you talking about?
You! Getting all irate about stuff. You know, there's people telling me I shouldn't even be your friend anymore.
Well, what do you think?
You know, I've known you since kindergarten. And I remember back when my mama started having her pill trouble, you and your mama let me stay with you. And I got to be a kid again. And I got to have fun. And you remember when your mom would take us to the Goodwill and we'd get those big old prom dresses and cut them down to size and hop around on the trampoline? Do you remember that?
I do.
I think that means a whole lot more than whether or not you're hugging on you some trees.
You know I never hugged a tree in my life.
Hey, Beth. Glad to see you.
Are you?
What's with that tongue?
You're gonna sell Grover's land. You're gonna put Gertie out.
I haven't signed any papers yet, Beth.
I bet you put him up to it, didn't
no,
you?
No, I can make my own decisions, Beth.
Didn't being out there with your papa looking at the boundaries mean anything to you?
Beth, it's a little bit more complicated.
No, it's not, James. Are you gonna let Mr. Dina and Dozer here tear all that down just so you and him can make a little bit of money?
Beth!
You see what good that money did your daddy, don't you?
You could have gone all day without saying that.
Grover's barely in the ground!
You know what, Beth?
Roger, don't. What?
You don't know what you're talking about.
I think I do.
You know, I've always liked you, Beth, but sometimes...
Roger, just go on. Do what you want to do. It's a free country. Y'all stop it now!
You think you're the only one who cares? You think you're the only one who cares about these mountains?
Then get down on the dozer!
You know, Beth, my high school graduation, there was no one there offering me a scholarship. It was my mother crying, and she thought I was dead, because she was so sure I was leaving and that she'd never see me again.
Yeah, but Roger, this...
And she didn't stop crying until I got that job at the mines. She acted like I won the lottery when I got that job.
Yeah, but that don't make it right.
What does it make it, Beth? Does it make it wrong?
Can you stop it? Stop it right now. You're my best friend, and you're my husband. Can I tell you what you're gonna do? Y'all gonna hug. She worried like you mean it. However you love her. And something else. You need to go fix things with James. Toss your tail over there and fix things with James.
if there's anything that belongs to you. So he walks in there with me, and he puts his arms around me, and he says,
"This is all I need."
I've decided to write you a prescription for pain.
God, will it ever work again?
I'm writing you a prescription for your pain. Take your medication and continue those exercises.
Now, God, you know how much those exercises hurt me? Sure, it works as a punishment.
Don't worry. This medication will kill your pain.
We'd like you to pay right when the doctor sees you.
You know what? You take all I got, too.
Did the doctor tell you about this stuff?
It was for pain.
It is, but take care that you don't take too much.
I don't take any more aspirin.
We'll need you to sign for what you can't pay for.
It's just not the same.
Mamaw, don't.
I'm
could get me a massage chair.
Mamma, just listen to me.
Frank and Fanny, they came and they was going to help us
two, three.
Careful, boys. Be careful there. Hold
on. Come on.
This way.
Back
this way.
No. At that way.
Oh, no. Be careful. No.
Back it up.
Careful. Careful.
No man knows where or when.
Get your house.
I just want to feel loved. I want to feel like something loves me and doesn't get mad all the time. Like I want to feel like everything loves me, you know? Just the couch, the room. It's just everything just loves you, you know? Sometimes it's like that, but most of the times it's just damn hard. And Brenda, I'm not trying. Brenda!
Somewhere I want somewhere.
he never knew, because she was a friend of his daughter, and she knew she wanted that bicycle. So right then, Carolyn got in and took him right out. Yeah. Took him out after that.
Valley may be yours, boy, but in the end, all is mine.
Can you find my devil, Lord?
Lord on the shade of cloudy day.
Shade of a cloudy day.
They were singing out about your glory, Lord, just before the valley washed away.
Where
do you find my table, Lord?
Hi, Mouse. Why do you stay here?
for real. Why do you stay here?
Well, you know, I've tried to leave here about 20 times or more, and every time I leave, something happens. Last time, Harvey's brother died, and, you know, he and I went to school together, and I stayed in the room. Then, with your cousin, and he had that accident and lost his leg, I stayed in the room.
Limehouse, I don't want James to sell his land.
Everybody's been down on here for a long, long time.
This place is dying.
You're talking to me, I'm the undertaker. You know, let's see, a couple of weeks ago, I went to that Eastern Kentucky Social Club reunion in Chicago. And then about 2 weeks later, I went to Los Angeles to that Rosemore reunion. And both times I walked in, I felt like I was in Harlem. This place won't ever die, as long as you people remember.
Yeah, but it ain't the same.
Well, you remember the one about the man that died and went to heaven?
Did what?
St. Peter was showing him around heaven and told him...
No. Limehouse, I'm tired of jokes and riddles and sweeping stuff under the rug. I'm tired of blah, 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 and everybody getting lockjaw when I want to talk about something serious, like unions or civil rights or women's rights. I'm tired of being shushed for talking about the land. I'm not a tree hugger, Limehouse. I'm mountain. Mountain as mountain can be. And I'm tired of people pushing me out the door, trying to make me leave. I want to be here, Limehouse. I don't want to be like a star in the sky. I want to be here, on the ground. I want to be mixed up in things. I want to be...
Talking dirt.
That's right.
Well, you better get somebody to back me.
Let us off at the Powell Bridge.
Methane.
Stink damp is hydrogen sulfide.
Black damp is nitrogen and carbon dioxide.
Damp is from Dampf, a German word for vapors.
It was a regular, normal day. Got up, pulled around the house a bit. I worked third shift, so I did a little yard work. Laid down for about an hour before work. Got up, got ready. Wife kissed me. Told me she loved me. Said she'd see me in the morning. She made promises, you know.
White damp,
fire damp, stink damp, black damp.
Got to work. Outside, we put our lights, our boots, and everything on. Started the shift, everything was fine. Took the man trip down to the coal face. Started cutting. Everything was going good that day.
White damp,
fire damp, stink damp, black damp.
We got up for lunch, and everybody was out talking like they always did. Somebody was missing a sandwich. No one would fess up to it, of course. But we knew who likely did it. My wife, she knew the business. She packed me a lot of things in my bucket. So I always had a sandwich to give to somebody. And I always had something to eat.
White damp,
fire damp, stink damp, black damp.
After lunch, we went back down to the coal face. Started cutting, and I noticed it was too soft. It felt too soft. The biting edge of the machine, it was taking too fast. And I looked to my friends, my coworkers, and said, "This is awful soft coal." And then the biting edge of the machine went through the wall. We had broken into an abandoned mine. It was on the wrong place on the map.
White damp,
fire damp, stink damp, black damp.
Air that just came out of it. It was like an ocean of water just pushing in through us. You could breathe, but you'd get no oxygen. You might as well have been breathing water. Nitrogen. Carbon dioxide.
White damp,
fire damp, stink damp, black damp.
We ran. We ran for our lives. We busted into an old mine that was supposed to be 500 feet above us. Black damp was pushing in on us. I had cut into black damp. And I was breathing into it. I ran 300 feet out of the sector. I was trying to gather the men to warn them about the danger that was coming behind me. It was coming fast. We got to the man trip and I noticed there were still two back there. And the boss man said, "I gotta go back in." We went back the way we came. And I tried my best. I tried to keep him to stay, but he just wouldn't do it.
"No, I gotta go get him. I gotta keep the belt while I'm running. We can ride it out. Now, y'all get out."
And that was the last time we saw him. I got out. Me and her repairman had gotten into the black damp pretty bad, so we had to go to the hospital. They gave us oxygen, and I told them I didn't know what was going on back at the mine. I had to go back. I was trained for rescue. I had to go back. They didn't want to release me, but I was willing to go. We went back in with gas masks and oxygen. Found him. All three men dead. We loaded their bodies on the man trip. And we brought the bodies out.
Nobody would say nothing much. Not at first. I have been friends with those guys forever. Me and Roy, we went to grade school together. We high school together. We graduated together. We worked at the same mine together. We worked at different mines together. When you're a coal miner, you become like brothers. It's cause you see them more than you almost do in your own family. Three of my brothers died. Black, Bam, Bam. And that boss, he was all right. He might steal a sandwich or two. That was just horsing around. But when push came to shove, he was like a good shepherd. He would go back out and find the sheep that was lost. I sure wish they let me still here, stealing every one of the sandwiches that I had. I used to take life for granted. You know, I was always looking to see the future hold, seeing what the future holds. Now, I don't do that anymore. I focus on now, who holds the future. And that's God. He's got it all in control.
Just once. I wish we'd break somebody out alive. Instead of just recovering a body.
I think that's why. I'll do this rescue stuff.
I gotta do it until I bring someone out alive.
I'm looking for the stone. You out of the mountain. I'm looking for the stone, come rolling down from Babylon. I'm looking for the stone, hewn out of the mountain, tearing down the kingdom of this world. My Jesus is the stone, hewn out of the mountain. My Jesus is the stone, come rolling down from Babylon. My Jesus is the stone, hewn out of the mountain, tearing down the kingdom of this
damp or something. You're running out of air, and you know it, so you start searching for something. Anything, something, store receipt, anything to write on. And then you realize that all you have to write with is your own blood. So in your own blood, you write, I love you. Because that's all you got room to say. You know, I've been thinking about that. And I got more to say. To my wife, Elizabeth, oh man, you've been the making and the breaking and the making of me. Time and again, long as I can remember. Words can't express this love I have for you.
This language, it just ain't big enough for it. To my sons, James and Paul, and my daughter, Melinda, I see myself in you. My graces and my failings. You're the very wheel of time as it rolls for me. You're my life ongoing. Can a man love something more than this life? I think he can. Our home, my work, little piddly things I do around the house. That old car that me and my boys been trying to get running forever and ever. All those little things. Little Debbie cakes. The Kentucky Wildcats football team, bless their little heart. I love those things too. Not in the same way, but I love them too. I want to say this now. I love this life that has been my life. And if I were to admit it, when it's my time to go, man, I'd like to be an old man in a comfortable bed. And I guess when that time comes, I'm going to be a little afraid. I guess we all are. But I don't want fear and regret to be the only things that I'm feeling. I want to say this now. I've been blessed beyond all I can name or understand. I have loved and I've been loved. And I've been amazed. I have been amazed.
Ahead and not the tail, you will prepare.
can't get anyone to talk to me about what to do with Papaw's land.
Man, I don't really know what to say.
It's all right. Carl, does this place ever get to you?
Of course it does. Man, this place can be a real torment.
How do you make it?
Well, I better not. You're just going to think I'm full of it.
No, I won't.
Well, when I was younger, my papa taught me that you could pour flour onto the back of a bee, which, you know, made it easier to see it. That way you could follow it back to its hive. He also taught me that you could take a chainsaw and sort of cut the hives out of the tree. And, you know, I done that too. But one day, I was carrying one of those beehives home with me. You know, that buzzing sound that the bees made, it almost started sounding like they were saying, "Stay." Like I start to hear stay everywhere I went. We held a mama in the garden and the sound that the tomatoes made coming off the vine sounded like stay, stay. Me and my little brother, we would go walking through the woods and the sound his little feet made rustling through the leaves sounded like stay, stay, stay. You know, one time I didn't even swear to you that I seen the word stay spelled out with the skin of my sword.
Wow.
Man, you think I'm a nut.
No.
You know, sometimes you just have to get somewhere where it's real good and quiet. Sit down and listen. Hear all kinds of stuff.
So you think I should stay?
Oh, I have no idea. But, you know, it was good talking about these kinds of things.
Who is that?
Women.
Is that right?
I didn't believe it either at first, but it's true. You might want to try talking to Beth again.
You know what? You're right. You're right. I should.
Would you care to...
Give me a hand.
On the discovery channel. said, all matter never goes away. It just changes shape. And we're all made of stardust.
Starlight? Well, maybe, but I like to think of it as the light of the Lord.
They said that we probably have atoms in us from Shakespeare. Some of us have atoms in us from the Rock of Gibraltar, and some of us from the wood of the cross.
Well, if that's true, then we're all connected.
A stranger stopped at a farmer's house one night, looking for shelter. Now this stranger, he had that crazy eye. He had that look of it. Now this farmer, he had kids, and he didn't want to put him in no danger. So he set the stranger up with a nice cot out on the front porch. And he told the stranger, now I'm going to lock this here door. That way you won't have to worry about what I might do to you, and I won't have to worry about what you might do to us. Later on, the man's wife asked him, why'd you let him stay there in the first place? He said, why? Well, because you never know. You never know which one might be the Lord.
Beth, they said it's going to start raining again tomorrow.
Well, let it rain because we're ready.
Shucks.
We ain't made of sugar.
Yeah.
exercise called Windows and Mirrors. We're just going to take a couple minutes. So you're going to turn to somebody sitting next to you, and maybe you know them, maybe you don't, and you're going to think for a moment about a window moment or a mirror moment. And a window moment is a moment where you experienced or saw something that gave you insight into a new experience or story. And a mirror moment is a moment where you feel like you saw something that was familiar or part of yourself. Make sense? Window, mirror? So we're just going to take a couple minutes to talk to the person next to you.